Hey guys.
Hey Bo.
Hi Bo.
Flippin' physics.
Ladies and gentle people, the bell has rung, therefore class has begun. Therefore, you should be seated in your seat, ready and excited to do an example problem about average velocity.
Yes.
Yep, sure.
Let's start by just reading the problem and then we'll translate the words into physics. Billy, could you just read the whole problem first, please?
Buster and Mr. P embark on a southward journey. First, they walk south at 6.5 kilometers per hour for 1.1 hours. Then, they stop to take a nap for 18 minutes. And then, continue south at 5.5 kilometers per hour for 1.2 hours. Part A, what was their average velocity for the whole trip? Part B, what was their displacement for the whole trip?
Great, Billy, could you again just start reading the problem? And Bo, could you please translate?
Buster and Mr. P embark on a southward journey. First they walk south at 6.5 kilometers per hour for 1.1 hours, then—
Please stop. Write all south, because everything's south in this problem. Velocity equals 6.5 kilometers per hour, and the change in time, or delta T, equals 1.1 hours.
Yes, Billy, please keep reading.
Then they stop to take a nap for 18 minutes and then continue south at 5.5 kilometers per hour for 1.2 hours.
Stop. Part. 18 minutes is change in time. And so is 1.2 hours, so another change in time, so two more changes in time. And then 5.5 kilometers per hour is velocity.
How can the change in time be 1.1 hours, 18 minutes, and 1.2 hours?
That is a great question, Bobby. It turns out that that can't be true.
Can we split the problem into three different sections?
Yes, we can split this problem into different sections or different parts. Yeah, so there are three different sections. You can see we have the change in time for part one is 1.1 hours, the change in time for part two is 18 minutes, and the change in time for part three is 1.2 hours. We're missing subscripts on these two velocities. Bobby, can you please help me?
6.5 kilometers per hour is the first velocity, and 5.5 kilometers per hour is the second velocity.
There are three parts, so I think there should be a third velocity.
I missed one. The second velocity is actually zero because they stopped to take a nap. Then the third velocity is 5.5 kilometers per hour.
Very good. People often, for some reason, overlook zeros because they think they're not important. However, zeros are very important, and it's very important that you write those down. So Buster and I stopped for 18 minutes, part two, and we took a nap. So we weren't actually moving, so our average velocity for part two was equal to zero. Billy, could you please keep reading?
Part A, what was their average velocity for the whole trip? Part B, what was their displacement for the whole trip?
I don't know what to tell you to write.
Well, I don't know what we're looking for.
Oh, right. Velocity equals question mark and delta x equals question mark because those are the two things we're trying to find.
You'll notice there are subscripts on all of our knowns, but what we're trying to find we don't have any subscripts on, so we do need subscripts on those. Billy, what subscripts should we have?
Those are both for the total trip or the whole trip, so we need to illustrate that they're both for the total trip. So do we write total?
Absolutely, we put a subscript of T on both of them. T, to illustrate that we're looking for the velocity and the displacement for the total trip, the whole thing. So T for total. Class, have we actually started solving this problem yet?
No.
Nope, not yet.
I have found in my experience that students have a tendency to just rush through a problem and try to solve the problem even before they understand it. It is very important that you slow down, write down everything that you know, what you're trying to find, and understand the problem before you try to solve it, please.
Should we convert the 18 minutes to hours now?
Bobby, that's a great idea. If you look at the givens, we have kilometers as our linear dimension, and as our time dimension, we have hours, 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 and this is the only one that's not in hours, it's in minutes. So yeah, Bobby, could you convert 18 minutes to hours, please?
There are 60 minutes in an hour, and we need to cancel out minutes, so multiply by 1 hour over 60 minutes.
That works out to be exactly 0.3 hours. So we multiply the 18 minutes, the change in time for part two, times 1 hour over 60 minutes. This means that the minutes are on top and bottom, therefore they cancel out, and we're left with only hours, or 18 over 60, or 0.3 hours. That's the change in time for part two. Now, when we have a problem that has multiple parts, sometimes I find that students see it better this way. So again, sometimes I find that students understand the givens better when there are multiple parts, when we set it up in a table form. So for example, we have in this column the part, in this column the change in time, and in this column the velocities. You can see I put the dimensions at the top so that we don't have to put them throughout the table. So for example, for part one, the change in time is 1.1 hours and the velocity for part one is 6.5 kilometers per hour. And you can see all the information in the table there. Bo, why don't you now work on part A, finding the average total velocity for, again, the total trip.
Well, I'm going to learn from last time and start with an equation.
Thank you, Bo. The equation is always a good place to start.
You're welcome. We know velocity equals change in position over change in time, so we have each velocity and change in time, so we can just solve for the displacement for each part.
Great, a good thing to do before we plug in numbers and solve for the displacement is actually to rearrange the equation and solve for that displacement just in terms of variables rather than plugging in numbers first, because we have multiple parts and we would just do it several times over and over again. So, Billy, could you please rearrange how to solve this equation for the change of position or the displacement, please?
Multiply both sides by delta t.
So you can see if we multiply both sides by the change in time cancels out on the right-hand side, and we're just left with the displacement. So the displacement ends up being equal to the change in time multiplied by the velocity. At this point, we can now go through and plug in the subscripts for each individual part. So let's go through and do that. So you can see we can substitute in the numbers for part one. We have the displacement for part one is equal to the change in time for part one multiplied by the velocity for part one. So the change in time for part one was 1.1 hours and the velocity for part one was 6.5 kilometers per hour. The hours cancel out and we're just left with kilometers. So who can tell me how many kilometers do we have as a displacement for part one, please?
That works out to be 7.15 kilometers.
So our displacement for part one is 7.15 kilometers. And, oh, you can see, I'm not writing south on these displacements or the velocities because everything is in the southern direction. We can do the same thing for part two now. So the displacement for part two is equal to the change in time for part two minus multiplied by the velocity for part two, which is going to be 0.3 hours times zero. And anything times zero is going to be equal to zero. And hopefully you should have recognized early on that the displacement for part two is going to be equal to zero because we're taking a nap. We're clearly not moving. But this is what it would look like mathematically, and that's important to be able to show. And again, we can do the same thing for part three. So again, for part three, we have the displacement for part three is equal to the change in time for part three multiplied by the velocity for part three, which is going to be equal to 1.2 hours times 5.5 kilometers per hour. Again, the hours cancel out, and again, we get kilometers for our dimensions. And what do we get for our displacement for part three, please?
Delta x equals 6.6 kilometers.
Oh, hey. Now that we have each individual displacement, we can solve part B.
Yeah, you just add all the displacements together to get the total displacement.
Yeah, that's true. Let's walk through that. So the total displacement is going to be equal to the displacement for part one plus the displacement for part two plus the displacement for part three. All we need now is the numbers. And what do we get now for our total displacement?
13.75 kilometers.
Safe and rounding.
14 kilometers south.
So it turns out that we get our answer for part B, actually, before we get the answer for part A. The total displacement is equal to 14 kilometers south. 14 kilometers in two segfegs, that would be the magnitude of the displacement, and south being the direction of the displacement. Back to the problem, we need to solve part A. Bo?
Oh, let's see. We need the total average velocity. So let's go back to the original equation for velocity and we add subscripts for total. Right, so we just come back to the original equation for velocity. Velocity equals change in position over change in time. We just add t's as subscripts for total. So the total velocity equals the displacement total divided by the change in time total. In part B, we actually already figured out the displacement total, so all we need at this point is the change in time total, the time for the entire event. Let's walk through that. So now what do we get for our total change in time?
2.6 hours.
Now that we have our change in time total and our displacement total, we can come back to the equation for velocity total, and we can just substitute in the numbers. So what do we get for our total velocity, please?
5.28846, and that rounds to 5.3 kilometers per hour south.
Yes, notice with sig figs, 5.3, so we have two sig figs. So 5.3 kilometers per hour is the magnitude of the velocity, and south being the direction. So the total average velocity is 5.3 kilometers per hour south.
Mr. P, why can't we just add the three velocities together and divide by three to get our average velocity?
That is a great question. It's one that I often get asked at this point. Let's walk through the numbers there, and we can talk about why this doesn't work. A lot of people simply want to add the three velocities together and divide by three in order to get the average velocity. And you can see when we do that, we get 4.583 repeating, which is clearly not equal to 5.28846. So the question is, why doesn't this work? Under what circumstances would this work? When could we simply add the three velocities together and divide by three to get the average velocity?
I think that only works if each part lasts for the same amount of time, right?
Yes, Bobby, the only time that this would work when we can add the three velocities together and divide by three to get the average velocity is if we drive at those velocities for the exact same amount of time. And clearly, that's rarely going to be the case. So you're going to have to go through and solve it the way that we talked about right here. That is my velocity example involving multiple parts. I hope you enjoyed learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.
Lecture notes are available at flippingphysics.com. Please enjoy lecture notes responsibly.
Do I look good?
Therefore, you should be seated in your seat. Therefore, you should be seated in your seat. Therefore, you should be seated in your seat. That's tough to say.
And this is going to be in velocities.
Try again.
This is...
Yeah.
So again, I find that some style of them would be if we're moving at the... is if we're driving at that average,